I will start when we sit down, please. And we still miss Ioana. Ah, she's here, okay. Okay, my name is Katarína Nevedelová, who doesn't know me. I'm the Vice President of the Party of European Socialists, and this is the last panel of today. It's a very short one, unfortunately, but I hope that we will enjoy our speakers anyway for a while. They will have 4 minutes, each of them, and I will be very strict with timing. So I will introduce the first one, who is John Krombes. He's the leader of the SPA from Belgium. He's my friend. When we first time met, it was at the meeting of the Senior Organization of European Socialists. And what can I say about John is that he's really very pragmatic, rational person. In the government, he was dealing with the tax fraud. And sorry for Elio, but we believe that one day he will be the Prime Minister of Belgium. So I'm giving the floor to him, and you have 4 minutes, please.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll do my best. Let me say by starting that, comrades, we are not against competition. It's a shame that Jeremy is not yet here, because we Belgium will play against England in a couple of months. And that sort of competition we like. But it's also the kind of competition where you have a football field with clear lines and clear rules. What I wanted to talk about is tax evasion, and in the way that Pierre Moscovici raised it and others before him, in a sense that I think that when people talk about tax evasion, and when we speak to the people of Europe about tax evasion, we have to be very clear on what we want. Because one of the problems is that if we just listen to the measures taken, it's BEPS, it's beneficial ownership, it's country-by-country reporting, it doesn't say a lot. I think we should be very clear on the fact that we want to take measures that make it impossible for some of the big companies or super-rich people stealing money from society should be stopped. And then we need to translate it by saying that societies that are used simply to make it possible that people are hiding their identity to steal from the rest of the society, we should make that illegal. And because one of the strange things is, if people don't understand the problem very well, they will perhaps not listen very well to the solutions. We had, and it's getting better and better, we had the Swiss leaks, we had offshore leaks, we had Panama Papers, but now we have Paradise Papers. It starts to sound like something that is attractive. We have Paradise Papers. But then you hear lots of people, even politicians, but certainly consultants, they say on television, well, perhaps it's not illegal what they do. Let's make it illegal. And I think on the measures that we take, we should be very clear on that. Also, the Young Socialists, the Yes people said, let's fight against tax evasion, but give the people some instruments. Give them instruments in a sense that we should simply, every time that they say it's perhaps not illegal, propose matter to make it illegal. And I find, and that's my question to you as well, that as social democrats in Europe, we should not hesitate. Because don't believe for a moment that when tax fraud, and let's call it tax fraud, not tax evasion, it's fraud, it's against the law, when tax fraud is high, that helps the economy. It doesn't. It helps shareholders. In countries where tax fraud is very high, they're putting pressure, downward pressure on salaries. It's not because they commit fraud that they're paying more to the workers. They don't. So let's be very, very specific on that. But by very well explaining what we want, let's attack the tax havens. Let's make legislation to forbid it. And then my last point, and I will end within the time given. I'm the first one, I think. It's possible. Let's make it clear to the people of Europe that it's possible. A couple of years ago, after the banking crisis, there was this possibility to end bank secrecy and to start automatic exchange of banking information. People thought that was impossible. But we did it. It's decided, it has been decided, and Pierre Moscovici was one of the people doing that. If they now think that it's impossible to really attack and destroy tax fraud, let's explain to the people that we can do it. We did it before, and we should do it again very clearly. 1 second, done. Thank you very
perfect.
Much.
Thank you very much, John. We believe that also in the European Union we will be able to face the tax havens, and we will start next week, hopefully. So without any more discussions, I will give the floor to Jeremy Corbyn. We are very much interested in what you would like to say. And when I was preparing for this meeting, I was just thinking about what to say about each of the speakers, and it's quite difficult to say something which nobody knows about Jeremy. So we know that he's enthusiastic, he brought young people back to Labour Party in Britain, he is interesting for the people, and we are interested in what you want to say to us. Thank you very much. You have 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, and thank you for inviting me onto the platform and the panel here today. First of all, I'm very sorry that I was unable to be here yesterday. We had a tragic death of one of our members of the Welsh Parliament, and I had to attend his funeral in North Wales yesterday to show support for the community and the family. And I've just had a very good meeting with our good friend António Costa, the Prime Minister of Portugal, and complimented him on the anti-austerity measures being taken by the government of Portugal, the growth in support for the Socialist Party and the left parties and the cause in Portugal because of that transformative agenda that's being offered. And I'm very pleased to be here in Lisbon this weekend to be having discussions with all of you on these processes. Our party in Britain has been through the general election campaign. We gained a great deal of support. We had the biggest growth in Labour support for many decades, and we have a very large party membership, and it's continuing to grow as a result. Sadly, we didn't quite win the election, and so we're faced with opposing our own government, which is continuing the process of austerity, which has resulted in real wages being lower than they were 10 years ago, with continued problems of funding of our health and education services and a continuing housing problem across Britain. The alternative that Labour is offering is of investment in our public services, investment in our young people by reducing the cost of university and college education, and of investment in our economy for growth in the future. And very strongly, which your previous speaker was just referring to, dealing with the issues which affect every one of us in this room of tax avoidance and tax evasion by the very wealthiest corporations and the very wealthiest individuals in the world. The Panama Papers should have been a warning to all of us, and insufficient action was taken to deal with the Panama Papers and the avoidance and evasion that was going on there. The Paradise Papers that have now exposed just how grotesque this is. If we want decent public services, if we want a society which does provide hope and opportunities for young people, it cannot be achieved if at the same time we do not deal with the obscenity of tax avoidance by the very biggest businesses and the wealthiest people in this world. And we are utterly determined to do that, and we push for that in opposition. And our Shadow Finance Minister, Shadow Chancellor of the Exchequer in Britain, John McDonnell, is leading on that. We're also faced with issues about our relationships with Europe. Everybody is very well aware of that. I just say these very brief words on it because the chair will stop me after 4 minutes. But I'll just say this. We are very proud to be members of the Party of European Socialists. Jan Royal is one of the vice presidents of the Party of European Socialists. We are committed to the strongest and closest possible relationship with all of our comrades all across Europe, whether they be countries in the European Union or socialists that are standing up for human rights and justice in countries outside the European Union, but nevertheless in Europe and therefore part of the Council of Europe, such as our friends in Turkey. We're utterly committed to the closest possible relationship. We might be, as a country having made a decision to leave the EU, we're not leaving Europe, we might be having a different relationship with the EU in the future. I want to make that very clear. Our commitment is, with everyone in this room, to build a Europe that works for the many, not the few, to deal with tax avoidance and tax evasion, and to be very proudly part of the European Convention on Human Rights and therefore adhering to the processes of the European Court of Human Rights. All of our rights are under threat if anyone leaves that process. The rise of the far right in various parts of Central Europe is a threat and a danger to all of us. As socialists, we learn from the history of appeasing the far right. You defeat the far right by the principles of the unity of all of us, of working class communities, of different ethnic communities, of the kind of society that we can live in. You don't defeat the far right by conceding any political ground to them. I'm very determined that we'll continue that message. And in finality, on the question of the negotiations over Brexit, we are committed to importing into British law the regulations on consumers, on environment, on employment and workers' rights into British law. We're committed to unilaterally legislating to guarantee all European Union nationals living in Britain their rights of permanent residence and their right to bring families to join them. We are proud of the very large number of people from all parts of Europe, indeed all parts of the world, that have made their homes in Britain and contribute to our society and our public services. So we offer them the hand of support and friendship. We would do that irrespective of any other aspects of negotiation. We also want to achieve a trade relationship with Europe that recognizes the interdependence of economies, particularly in the manufacturing sector, on both sides of the channel, because we want nobody who voted to leave the European Union, and a majority did in Britain, did not vote to cut jobs, did not vote to reduce living standards. The offer Labour made in the general election was of an anti-austerity government, a government that would invest for the future. And if ever a general election comes very soon, we're absolutely ready for it. We will take an offer out to the British people of a society that's based on social justice, that's based on opportunities, that doesn't punish young people and doesn't walk by on the other side at grotesque levels of poverty that are created by inequality in our society. That's what unites us all across this continent, and that is what we can work together on an anti-austerity agenda for economic and social justice right across the continent. And the Labour Party is very much part of that determination and part of that process. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We are very happy and we hope to maintain a very good relationship with Britain and also with the Labour Party on with your behalf. And also I would like to say that we are very happy that some of our leaders, or all of our leaders, and especially you, is committed to work with young people, because this is the future and it's very important for the socialist movement. My next speaker is also a very interesting person, Niels Ušakovsk, is it correct?
Close enough.
Who is the leader and the chairman of the Social Democratic Party Saskana. He is the mayor of Riga, and when I was searching information about you, it was also kind of interesting for me that to see that you like cats. I saw that you like cats very much, but most important fact is this: you are the only one of the leaders of the Social Democratic Party of Europe, which I know about, is a mayor of the capital city of his own country and is also the chairman of the Social Democratic Party. So the floor is yours, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Yeah, we used actually cats in our campaign during one of the election rounds, and it helped. Well, everyone likes cats. Well, I come from the country which regained independence back in 91. And we are the country that has never ever had any single social democratic government since 91. Back in 2009, we won election in Riga and a number of other cities. And since that time, we're using cities as a showroom for social democratic policy, showing our citizens what can be done if you've got social democrats in power. Since 2009, and we do understand that Latvian government has always been extremely conservative and right-wing, and it was kind of an example of austerity policies. It was cutting down pensions by 10%, I remember, in 2010. We, at the same time, were introducing new and new elements of social democratic policies. And as a result, apart from bringing social democracy to our citizens, For instance, back in 2013, when we had election, right-wing parties were calling us left populists. In 2017, right-wing parties were copying our 2013 program, trying to outperform us in Riga. They failed. But what we see right now, using our Latvian experience and talking about future of the continent, we do understand that future of the European continent is highly dependent on what's going on with the cities. And cities are not only the engine for the economical growth, it's not only the place where the majority of population live. Cities, towns, municipalities is a place where we serve basic needs of our citizens when we talk about social problems and other problems. And that means that cities, by definition, are left. That's a place where social democrats must be performing all the time. And what we understand is that we've got prominent mayors of capitals, cities and towns all over Europe. I mean, Paris, London, Berlin, Stockholm, Copenhagen, Vienna, Lisbon, many other capitals. Brussels. Thousands of large cities, hundreds of towns are run by social democrats, socialists and labor parties. And it's a huge asset for our family. We are talking about 2019. We are talking about bringing European values, explaining European values to our citizens, to persuade them to participate in the election 2019. Mayors can connect high values of the European Union with basic needs of their citizens. Mayors can really help in bringing activity up, explaining to the citizens that it's important to go and to vote for the European Parliament. And what we really need, I believe, is to create PES mayors network in order to show better results in 2019. I've used my time talking to Sergei Stanishev, to Karina Kretsa, to fellow mayors about such a tool to be used for the run by the family. And since we're newcomers, we've been upgraded by the last presidency to the full membership level, optional before the Congress, we are supposed to be pretty active. So Latvian Social Democrats, my comrades, I myself, will be communicating with our family very actively, trying to persuade that we need mayors to help our family in 2019. And I've got 42 seconds left because, well, we're a new party. We are following the rules, at least for some period. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Niels. Thank you very much, and welcome to the family. That's what I forgot to say. That's just kind of was adopted in the presidency meeting as the 34th member of the family, and will be confirmed hopefully in the next Congress as the full membership for the party. The next and the last beautiful one is my friend Joanna. Joanna Ortega, she is the former UC vice president. She's coming from Paraguay, so she is our international guest from PPS party. And she would consider herself as a feminist socialist, which is very nice. And she will speak in Spanish as well, so I would like to ask you to put your headsets if you don't have them. And she will speak about the cooperation and work in Latin America. So Joanna, the floor is yours, please.
Muchas gracias y gracias a PES por la invitación para estar acá compartiendo con ustedes y comentarles un poco también de la experiencia que tenemos desde el progresismo y desde los partidos de izquierda en América Latina. Los socialistas y los socialdemócratas en el mundo y en América Latina siempre hemos propuesto esta idea de un mundo mejor y de los sueños por cumplir para la gente. En América Latina, durante la década de los 2000, desde principios de los 2000, hemos tenido la posibilidad de gobernar en distintos países y quizás mostrarle a la gente de que es posible cumplir esos sueños. Propusimos políticas que verdaderamente transformaron la vida de la gente. En Brasil, entre el 2006 y el 2016, 30 millones de personas salieron de la pobreza. En distintos países de América, como Uruguay y Argentina, el progresismo le dio como Chile y Argentina, el progresismo le dio a la gente sus dos primeras mujeres presidentas en la historia de estos países. Además, hemos propuesto desde las juventudes lo que nosotros llamamos la nueva agenda de derechos, en la cual propusimos, entre otras cosas, el matrimonio igualitario, la legalización del aborto y la decisión sobre nuestros propios cuerpos. También la legalización del cannabis, entre otras políticas que mejoraron definitivamente la vida de la gente. Es verdad que nosotros propusimos una vida digna para la mayor parte de la población durante esa década. ¿Y qué pasó después? Entendimos, mediante distintas lecciones que tuvimos en países como Honduras, Paraguay y últimamente Brasil, que hay algo que no teníamos garantizada y que es la democracia y el acceso a ella. distintas fuerzas de derecha renovaron sus formas de acceso al poder, generando golpes incluso desde el Parlamento a nuestras democracias. Y por lo tanto entendimos que ninguno de los derechos que nosotros conquistamos para la gente durante los gobiernos en esa década estaban garantizados si ni siquiera la democracia estaba garantizada. Así que como reflexión, lo que quiero plantear es que nosotros, si bien vivimos este periodo, tenemos ahora un regreso de esta derecha neoliberal que viene a recortar todos los derechos que nosotros propusimos para la ciudadanía y que viene también a decirnos de que también nosotros tenemos que reinventarnos. Porque sí hay algo que estuvo ausente durante esta década de oro que nosotros llamamos nuestros gobiernos progresistas en la región, y tiene que ver con la renovación. La juventud tuvo un escaso acceso a las posiciones de poder político durante este tiempo. Y esto es fundamental en una región en la cual la juventud verdaderamente es la que lidera los procesos de renovación y cambio en nuestros países. Creo que esa es una reflexión que debemos hacer desde la izquierda y definitivamente tratar de compartir estas propuestas que nosotros tenemos como socialistas y socialdemócratas. En los últimos tiempos, sí, las juventudes han tenido mayor protagonismo, trayendo esta idea de que podemos compartir sueños entre distintas generaciones y de que podemos proponerle a la gente verdaderamente vivir esos sueños. Nosotros venimos a proponer el recorte de la brecha que separa a los ricos de los pobres, sociedades con mayor igualdad y acceso a oportunidades y sobre todo la solidaridad por sobre el individualismo y la participación de toda la ciudadanía en la construcción de las decisiones del futuro de nuestros pueblos. En fin, y debemos decirlo claramente, nosotros venimos a remover esos privilegios que hicieron que algunos puedan vivir por muchos años y siglos oprimidos, mientras que una minoría vivió oprimiéndonos. Así que quiero terminar, para no excederme en el uso del tiempo, con una frase de Eduardo Galeano, que es un poeta uruguayo, y quizás Uruguay es en América Latina el mayor ejemplo de lo que el progresismo y la izquierda unida puede lograr, y Eduardo Galeano nos decía esto: la utopía está en el horizonte, me acerco dos pasos y ella se aleja dos pasos, me acerco y camino 10 pasos y el horizonte de la utopía se desplaza 10 pasos más allá. Por mucho que camine, nunca la alcanzaré. Entonces, ¿para qué sirve la utopía? Sirve para eso, para caminar. Sigamos entonces caminando en el camino de la utopía de este mundo mejor y este mundo posible que queremos construir para todas y todos. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Joanna. I forgot to mention that Joanna is also the head of the International Department of Paraguay, so you see the future is bright and beautiful, and it belongs to the women. So thank you very much for this update, and I would like to thank also to my panelists. I would like to thank them that they were sticking, almost all of them, to the timeline I gave them. So I would like to thank to Jeremy, to Joanna, to John, and to Niels, and I would like to ask you for a big applause, and I'm giving the floor to Jen Royal and Rory Quinn. Thank you.